The Sanctuary by E.F. Benson, narrated by Trevor O'Hare. Chapter 1. Francis Elton was spending a fortnight's holiday, 1 January, in the Engadine when he received the telegram announcing the death of his uncle, Horace Elton, and his own succession to a very agreeable property. The telegram added that the cremation of the remains was to take place that day, and it was therefore impossible for him to attend, and there was no reason for his hurrying home. In the solicitor's letter that reached him 2 days later, Mr. Angus gave fuller details. The estate consisted of sound securities to the value of about £80,000, and there was as well Mr. Elton's property just outside the small country town of Wedderburn in Hampshire. This consisted of a charming house and garden and a small acreage of building land. Everything had been left to Francis, but the estate was saddled with a charge of £500 a year in favor of the Reverend Owen Barton. Francis knew very little of his uncle, who for a long time had been much of a recluse. Indeed, he had not seen him for nearly 4 years, when he had spent 3 days with him at this house at Wedderburn. He had vague but slightly uneasy memories of those days, and now on his journey home, as he lay in his berth in the rocking train, his brain, rummaging drowsily among its buried recollections, began to disinter these. There was nothing very definite about them. They consisted of suggestions and sidelights and oblique impressions, things observed, so to speak, out of the corner of his eye and never examined in direct focus. He had only been a boy at the time, having just left school, and it was in the summer holidays, hot, sultry weather of August, he remembered, that he had paid him this visit, before he went to a crammer's in London to learn French and German. There was his uncle Horace, first of all, and of him he had vivid images. A gray-haired man of middle age, large and extremely stout, with a cushion of jowl overlapping his collar, but in spite of this obesity, he was nimble and light in movement, with a merry blue eye that was equally alert and seemed constantly to be watching him. Then there were two women there, a mother and daughter, and, as he recalled them, their names occurred to him, too. They were Mrs. Isabel Ray and Judith. Judith, he supposed, was a year or two older than himself, and on the first evening had taken him for a stroll in the garden after dinner. She had treated him at once as if they were old friends, had walked with her arm round his neck, had asked him many questions about his school, and whether there was any girl he was keen on. All very friendly, but rather embarrassing. When they came in from the garden, certainly some questioning signal had passed between the mother and the girl, and Judith had shrugged her shoulders in reply. Then the mother had taken him in hand. She made him sit with her in the window seat, and talked to him about the crammers he was going to. He would have much more liberty, she supposed, than he had at school, and he looked the sort of boy who would make good use of it. She tried him in French, and found he could speak it very decently, and told him that she had a book which she had just finished, which she would lend to him. It was by that exquisite stylist Hovsman, and was called La Basse. She would not tell him what it was about. He must find out for himself. All the time those narrow gray eyes were fixed on him, and when she went to bed, she took him up to her room to give him the book. Judith was there, too. She had read it, and laughed at the memory of it. "Read it, darling Francis," she said, "and then go to sleep immediately, and you will tell me tomorrow what you dreamed about, unless it would shock me." The vibrating rhythm of the train made Francis drowsy, but his mind went on disintegrating these fragments. There had been another man there, his uncle's secretary, a young fellow, perhaps 25 years old, clean-shaven and slim with just the same gaiety about him as the rest. Everyone treated him with an odd sort of deference, hard to define but easy to perceive. He sat next to Francis at dinner that night, and kept filling his wine glass for him whether he wanted it or not, and next morning he had come into his room in pajamas, sat on his bed, looked at him with odd questioning eyes, had asked him how he got on with his book, and then taken him to bathe in the swimming pool behind the belt of trees at the bottom of the garden. No bathing costume, he said, was necessary, and they raced up and down the pool and lay basking in the sun afterwards. Then from the belt of trees emerged Judith and her mother, and Francis, much embarrassed, draped himself in a towel. How they all laughed at his delightful prudery, and what was the man's name? Why, of course, it was Owen Barton, the same who had been mentioned in Mr. Angus' letter as the Reverend Owen Barton. But why Reverend, Francis wondered. Perhaps he had taken orders afterwards. All day they had flattered him for his good looks.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.